Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. Our first item of business this morning is a decision on taking item 3 in private. Item 3 is the consideration of the evidence that we've heard on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. Are we agreed to take this item in private? We are agreed. So our second item of the agenda is the main item of business this morning, which is our second stage one evidence session on the Land Reform Scotland Bill. This is the first panel of legal advisers that the committee will hear from during the course of this bill, and it is likely that we will be having a second panel after the recess. So pleased to welcome this morning Gail Watt, the convener of Property, Land and Law Reform Subcommittee for the Law Society of Scotland.
Fergus Cahoon.
Perfect. I got it right through you, who's an advocate for the Faculty of Advocates. And I'd also like to welcome Dr. Jill Robbie, the Senior Lecturer for the School of Law for the University of Glasgow, and Don McLeod, the partner of Turk & Connell. Now, as I did last week, I want to declare an interest that I have in a farming partnership in Moray. It's all set out in my register of interest, but specifically I declare an interest as an owner of approximately 500 acres of farmed land, of which approximately 50 acres is woodland. I also declare that I'm a tenant of approximately 500 acres in Moray under a non-agricultural tenancy, and that I have another farm tenancy under the Agricultural Holdings Scotland Act 1991. And I also declare that sometimes I take on grass lets on an annual basis. Now, I think the Deputy Convener is going to make a somewhat shorter declaration.
Thank you, Convener. I would also just want to draw Parliament to my register of interest that I am a trained lawyer, and while I'm no longer a member of the Law Society, I am on the role of Scottish solicitors, and I also, just for transparency, should state that Dr. Jill Robbie and I used to work together in private practice.
Oh, perfect. Thank you very much. What we're going to do is we're going to go through the first part of the bill, part one of the bill, and then we'll suspend the meeting briefly to allow a change of witness, where I think Don is stepping down and Grierson Dunlop's going to take over, and I also believe that Jill Robbie's going to leave us at that stage because part one is her specialty. So let's go on to the questions, the easy bit. So I'm just going to ask each of you very briefly to explain what your experience in land management and how you're there. So if we start from my right, your left, Gail, that's you first. Could you just say a wee bit about your experience and we'll work along the line?
Good morning. I am the convener of the Law Society's Property and Land Law Reform Subcommittee. We are a group of around nine solicitor members and non-solicitor members with experience or interest in land reform and property reform in Scotland. As part of our response to the bill, the Law Society set up a wider working group which took in members from our environmental law subgroups, our rural subgroups, and also had feed-in from our tax and planning subgroups. In my day-to-day life, I am an agriculture and rural property solicitor, legal director with 20 years experience in this area.
Thank you very much, Gail. Fergus.
My name is Fergus Cahoon. I am an advocate, a member of faculty, which is Scotland's independent referral bar. My personal practice area includes rural property and agricultural property particularly, and on that basis I was included in preparing faculty's response to this consultation, and I've been asked to come and speak on faculty's behalf to that response.
Thank you very much, Fergus. Don.
So I act for large landholders, and that covers families who have owned estates for generations. It covers clients who are buying large landholdings, clients who are selling large landholdings. I act for charities who own large landholdings. I act for farmers. I act for forestry investors. And I act for a number of parties in the emerging natural capital and carbon market in the UK.
Thank you. Jill.
Hello. So I'm an academic lawyer at the University of Glasgow. I should mention also that I'm deputy chair for Nature Scot, but I'm not giving evidence in that capacity today. I've written and researched in this area of land reform and property law. I've written on carbon trading and community rights to buy. I've previously given evidence on the previous land reform bill, and I'm also a member of the Land and Human Rights Forum of the Scottish Land Commission.
Thank you very much, Jill. Well, the first question is going to come from the Deputy Convener, Ben.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you all for your time and your submissions in advance. And just giving you the opportunity to build on those written submissions, we would be interested for an outline of your views on the need for further land reform and whether the bill as drafted will improve transparency, strengthen the rights and sustainable development of communities, and ensure sufficient and adequate supply of land. And perhaps Dr. Robbie, I don't know if you want to begin.
Thank you. I think that there is still a persistent need for measures to tackle the concentration of ownership in Scotland. There is ongoing evidence that relates to the negative consequences of the concentration of ownership in Scotland in terms of social and environmental consequences. That is published by many research organisations as well as the Scottish Land Commission. I have my reservations as to whether this bill will address those underlying problems, which I've given an outline of in my evidence, my submitted evidence, but I'm happy to go into further detail.
And just on that, just for the benefit of those who haven't read your submission, do you want could you tell us a bit more about what you think is good in the bill and what could potentially be strengthened in your view?
I think the land management plans are a really positive development. I think they could be strengthened, but the position that large-scale land holdings should publish a land management plan that includes topics like how the estate is contributing to increasing biodiversity and contributing to net zero, I think is positive. In relation to the extended opportunity for community rights to buy, I think that's, as I said, a highly technical amendment to a highly technical procedure, which is so strictly defined in terms of timescales. I don't think it's ever going to be used unless in extremely specific circumstances. And in relation to lotting, I am worried about natural capital developments in Scotland, which is not covered in the bill at all, and the interaction between lotting and the purchase of land for natural capital could lead to negative consequences for communities and other rural employment opportunities, for example.
And just touching on communities, you say in your written response that a legal obligation of community engagement will allow those impacted by the decisions of the owner to have a say in the management of the land. Do you want to just elaborate a bit on that?
Yeah, so at the moment, I think community engagement is very much recommended practice. And to have an obligation for community engagement is a step up in Scotland's process of land reform, I think. And I think that that's exciting and important. But if it's just that you have to engage with communities and nothing more, there's not more sanctions for the types of obligations which would be put into a land management plan, then you, it's quite a basic requirement that could be met by a large-scale landowner.
Thank you. Colleagues may want to drill into some more of that later, but Don McLeod, thanks for waiting patiently. I don't know if you want to go back to my initial questions.
Yeah, so thinking about necessities on transparency, first of all, I don't think the bill adds anything. So that under the 2016 Act, there was a very complicated piece of legislation in terms of what became the Register of Controlling Interests in Land, and that really is a very effective tool for land transparency in terms of ownership. There are pretty limited exemptions from that. And a lot of my clients spent a lot of time going through that and making their registration. So in terms of transparency, no, I don't think the bill is necessary in that regard and doesn't add anything. More generally, I think my overriding comment on the bill would be it doesn't make any sense that the government have done this without letting the review of the rights to buy settle. So rights to buy are the very heartbeat of land reform for the last 20 years. And what this bill does in relation to the Part 1 provisions is layers on top of the existing legislation and the rights to buy even more regulation and legislation. It doesn't make any sense at all, to my mind, excuse me, that the right to buy review is happening separate to the bill, because things might come out of that that mean that this bill has to be changed again. And I also think that the government haven't really grasped the full utility of the current rights to buy. So I would say lotting is unnecessary, because at the moment, under the rights to buy, the communities can do their own lotting. They can register their interest in the land that they want to buy. They can do that themselves. It doesn't need the government to make that happen. And if they really want to buy a piece of land, then they have four rights to buy where they can register. The process is, it's a legal process. There are bits to it, but it's not that difficult. So is this really actually necessary? And is it necessary pending the review of the rights to buy? And I don't think it is.
So can I just
clarify? My understanding is that the community right to buy will be put out for consultation this summer and reporting in 2025. Is that right? Is that your understanding?
My understanding was it's the review process has started and it will be finished by the end of 2025. So on current timescales, it will be after this bill.
Sorry.
No problem, Camilla. Thank you. So just listening carefully to that and also having read your submission, I'm not clear where the line of argument is. You don't think there needs to be further primary legislation on land reform, or there could potentially be further primary legislation on land reform in your view, but you think this timing is incorrect because of the review that's taking place over community right to buy?
Yes.
Is there an open-mindedness to change?
Yes, absolutely. And I think, so it is the latter. I think the government have to accept that the community right to buy, as they stand, they don't work. So the sustainable development right to buy, there are, I think, four registrations in 4 years. The abandoned and neglected land right to buy, I think there are three registrations in 7 years, or it's the other way around. For the ordinary community right to buy, there have only been two applications this year, and there are only 21 that are currently registered. Something's not working if this is the policy of the government. The rights to buy are not functioning. So I think that's where the government should be focusing their attention, to make them work better if there is a need and if there is a demand from communities for that to happen.
Just one more question before we hear from the other panellists. I read with interest in your written submission, you talked about the marketability of land in Scotland. Just for full clarity, do you want to say a bit more about why you think that's important and why you would want Scotland's land to be marketable? Because I'm not sure that everyone would agree with that point.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it comes down to the preservation of private property rights and what extent can the state control that. And there are constraints already in terms of rights to buy, well, planning, infrastructure issues, environmental laws. There's a whole range of things that impinge upon private ownership. In my opinion, talking to clients and others in the industry, there is a lot of concern, particularly in relation to lotting, that the state may be able to impose how a private property right is sold, how it's dealt with. Mm-hmm. That is a concern.
But that doesn't necessarily directly relate to inward investment. I guess I'm just trying to get a sense of. Mm-hmm. There's many who argue in Scotland that land in Scotland isn't well used enough, mm-hmm. as things stand. And the line of argument I'm reading from the submission is that you think that we should be able to trade land and incentivise inward investment, and you're concerned that this bill might have an impact on that. I'm just trying to get a sense of where your line of argument is there, because I'm not clear.
Okay, so I mean, I think a free trading property market, I think that's absolutely necessary in any civilised legal system, and there are constraints over that. That's accepted, but it's to what extent you go towards more state control than less state control. So I do believe that a free property market is important. And if you look at inward investment, and if we join that with natural capital, some people will not like it. But what is happening at the moment is that inward investment is making nature restoration happen in terms of planting trees and restoring peatlands at scale. And that is happening. There's no denying that. That is how it's going. And if the government wants that to happen, as a policy objective, will this bill put off inward investment, appreciating that not everyone will be on board with that happening? I think it will.
And is there any evidence base for that?
So I could introduce you to several people who are behind the inward investment in natural capital who will tell you that, yes. They will tell you they're going to London and they're trying to do their next raise to do peatland restoration or tree planting, and they're finding it pretty difficult because they hear you need the government's permission before you sell land, and that's not exactly correct, but it's the kind of the point. And also, you may not be able to sell your land as you please in the future because of an extremely complicated, possibly even unworkable, lotting rule.
Well, I think the committee will need to examine those potential sources of evidence more carefully. I'm conscious I'm taking up a lot of time, Convener, so I'll let our other two witnesses respond.
I thought
respond
it was your session
points.
This morning, Deputy Convener Fergus.
I suppose I can speed things up. I don't think the faculty has a huge amount to say in response to the question that you asked. Those are sort of practical and policy-related questions for the committee, and we don't really take a view on that.
Appreciate that. Thank you. Gil Watt.
The society very much echoes what Fergus has just said. That being said, legal reform is essential for creating good law and improving the law in Scotland. The Law Society do not comment on policy, but any reform that is carried out here has to have full cognizance of the overlaps and duplications with the live reviews that are currently ongoing to current legislation. They have to be properly interrogated and reported on. Otherwise, we're going to end up with an approach which is not consistent and not aligned. And that will lead to confusion by not just lawyers, by the people who are going to be affected.
And just on that, do you think there's scope for this bill to have a more effective or a potentially more effective consolidating impact?
Potentially. It's not something that we looked at in terms of the in terms of our response here, but I think there is a potential for that. But that's a much wider piece in terms of the review of the ongoing legislation and the ongoing consultations and the impact that it's going to have on the existing legislation and commercial arrangements that are already in place.
Okay, thank you.
Mark, you wanted to come in briefly, I think, with a supplementary.
Yes. I mean, Dr. Robbie, you're saying about natural capital regulation not being part of this bill. What sort of form do you think that regulation could take? And then maybe for Mr. McLeod, would that regulation potentially deliver more certainty for investors, depending on what it looks like?
So I think in the context of land transactions at the moment in Scotland, natural capital is a driver, an important driver. And there is emerging evidence that there is investment motivated actors are taking part in land transactions in order to set up natural capital projects through carbon trading. There's also an associated risk with that of the implications in terms of community benefit and unwanted environmental impacts. The natural capital market at the moment really relies on two PDFs and a website, really. And the underlying system is environmental property laws that already exist. So the way that this could interact with land reform, I think, in the context of lotting, is that if you don't have any restrictions on the buyer of a lotting decision and there's new investment-motivated actors, then you can really facilitate the transfer of Scotland's land into these new actors because of natural capital, potential natural capital projects. So it's that interaction that worries me. The existing community rights to buy are so targeted as to who is the beneficiary, and there needs to be a connection with the land, and you know, you need a approval of the body by the Scottish ministers, all of that. Lotting doesn't have any of that. There's no restriction on the buyer. So that's what worries me from this perspective. There could be, I think, further regulation of natural capital in this bill, if that's what was wanted, desired.
Yeah, okay, Mr. McLeod.
In my opinion, natural capital is already very heavily regulated. So the two PDFs that Jill mentions, I think, are actually excellent. So it's the Woodland Carbon Code, which regulates natural capital carbon related to trees, and the Peatland Code, which regulates peatland restoration and natural capital units that come from that. I think that layer of regulation is first class, and the UK standards are held out around the world as very good standards. That's that aspect. If you want to plant trees...
They're not in law, though, are they?
They're not in law, no. They are part of the voluntary carbon market. Right. Yeah. So if you are creating carbon units under these codes with the recognition and the endorsement of the codes, you've got to play by their rules. And the science is very developed and the regulation is very good.
That regulates what? It doesn't regulate who, which I think was Dr. Robbie's point. But
That's right, yes. But then if you want to plant trees, the process for planting trees is really quite complicated. You have to go through a very detailed, pretty expensive consents process with Scottish Forestry. They typically take ages to give you your consent. 2 years is not unheard of. That is very heavily regulated as well. If you want to restore peatland, the consequences of that may be much less significant. You're complying with the peatland code as the standard. You need to give prior notification to the planning authority. Most of the time, you don't need planning permission. But there really is a big process around this already. So I would say that the regulation is very good.
Okay.
Thanks. Now, Bob, I think you've got a sequence of questions.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for supporting what evidence taking for this legislation. Can I stick with large-scale land holdings and land management plans? With the Scottish Land Commission here last week, and I noted to them that their recommendation had been for land management plans to start maybe at 1,000 hectares, with 3,000 at the upper end of where it might start. And the Scottish Government went for 3,000 hectares, which, as a city boy, I don't really know what a hectare is, but it's 30 million square metres, which seems quite big. Several thousand football pitches, we'll get Euro 24 on at the moment. Is that maybe a wee bitty high
for starting with land management plans at 3,000 hectares? Just maybe just an initial view of each witness, Dr. Robbie?
Yes, I think 3,000 hectares is high. It could certainly be lower. Also, it doesn't quite make sense that there is a test for lotting, which is 1,000, and land management plans is 3,000. So just for the sake of consistency, I think having the same threshold would be useful. Other stakeholders have suggested lower thresholds, with 500 hectares being suggested as well. So I definitely think 3,000 is a high threshold.
Thank you. And for witnesses, just to get an initial viewpoint on record about this, we'll move on to other related questions. Mr. McLeod?
So two thoughts from me. One is the accuracy of the data in terms of transactions. Now, I think the Commission reports are excellent, but I do think there are issues with the underlying data. And if you take what they have already, and then if you layer on top of that the composite holding test, the situation could be quite different. So if they are saying that there are X number based on 1,000 hectares, that may be so. But then if you take in the composite holding rules, there may be aggregation. So it just changes the figures. And I don't know what the outcome would be, but it changes the figures. And I think there's a real issue with data accuracy. I'm not sure how you'd get it better.
But can I check, Mr. McLeod, 30 million square metres is 30 million square metres, irrespective of what the data shows. Is that too big, too small, just about right?
So that was my first point, was just questioning the underlying data.
Yeah.
Secondly, I think it's arbitrary that 1,500 hectares has been chosen. I really just can't understand the distinction. I did listen to the evidence from the Commission last week, and I think they cited resource issues. I would invite the Commission to be a bit more ambitious, in the sense that land management plans, their job is largely receiving the plan and making it public.
We'll come on to that in a second, Mr. McLeod. Honestly, it's a really straightforward question. Do you think 30 million square metres is too high, too small, just about right?
I don't want to stop you. It just makes it easier for me, because I'm a simple soul. When we talk about square metres, can we talk about hectares?
So 3,000.
Just so I understand.
A lot of people watching, 3,000 hectares will just be a random number, but 4,000 or 5,000 football pitches is a meaningful amount. 30 million square metres means a lot to people. I'm not even saying what my view is, Mr. McLeod. It really is just a wee starter question for 10, if you like. Too high, too low, just about right.
So, instinctively, it feels too high, because there's all kinds of land managers who are doing things that wouldn't be covered by land management plans, and who may have an excellent contribution if they had to do a land management plan.
And I'm sorry, but that's really helpful. That's what I wanted to get to. That's really helpful for our evidence, Mr. Cahoon.
I don't think I could say. 1,000, 3,000, again... that's not a matter on which we would have any expertise. So my feeling would be as good as yours.
Okay. And likewise, that's why I'm trying to elicit evidence from people with an expertise to work out how I feel about it. Gail Watt?
Society has no view on the actual hectareage limits that are imposed here, although we would say that whatever those are and whatever those are agreed upon to be, it has to be supported by robust evidence for the reason for the choosing of those levels.
Which is very helpful, and we'll come on to more of that in a second. And I apologise to witnesses in advance for kind of moving people on, because there's lots of questions to get through. I'm trying to get where witnesses are and then move on to the next question and speed delayed. If that comes across a little bit rude, I apologise about that. I just kind of wanted to get there. So there's no point having land management plans unless there's a system of compliance. Now, talk a little bit more in a moment about what that means in practice. So if we could assume, and it's a big assumption, I know, Mr. McLeod, there has been non-compliance. But let's play that game for a wee second. The maximum fine is capped at £5,000. Do witnesses feel that's about right? It feels, again, I don't have a background in this, but it feels pretty low to me. And we'll come on to cross-compliance in a second, penalties, but for direct penalties, £5,000, about right, too low, too high. I'll start with maybe Gail Watt this time.
In our response, we were very clear that whatever levels of penalties that are imposed here have to be proportionate and reasonable. Although as part of our discussions leading up to that, there was commentary from several members on the fact that whatever, as an aside to that, whatever level obviously has to have a deterrent attached to it. Otherwise, what's the point? Someone will just pay it, walk away, and that's it, job done.
So I agree with all of that, but that doesn't take a view on the level of the fine. So do you think that fine acts as an adequate deterrent?
That's not for us to make a comment on as the Law Society. Whatever the level is agreed, it has to be made sure that it is proportionate and reasonable, but also has a deterrent attached to it.
Okay. Would you have a view on whether it was affordable?
No. No view on that.
Okay. So you wouldn't have a view on whether if someone had like 3,000 hectares that they were, you know, they were managing, that a £5,000 fine in that respect would be affordable to them or not?
We don't have a view on that.
Okay. Fergus Cahoon?
No view on the level of the fine as such. What I would observe is that £5,000 is the current statutory limit for a fine imposed by a sheriff on summary conviction in a criminal matter. And my presumption would be that that is why £5,000 has been chosen. The proposed fines in the bill are certainly summary in nature, and albeit non-criminal. It would perhaps feel slightly strange for them to be substantially different or substantially greater than the fine that a sheriff could impose if this were prosecuted as a summary, as an offence under summary procedure in the
okay,
court.
That's really helpful. So would that be a barrier to making it greater than £5,000? Is there an impediment to going further, irrespective of whether it's affordable or not affordable?
Not that I can see. It wouldn't be a barrier as such. The proposal is that the fine would be imposed by the commissioner and subject to the review of the Lands Tribunal rather than subject to the review of the sheriff or being imposed through a criminal process.
That's really helpful. Ms. McLeod?
Yes, I think in the context that Fergus has just described, I think £5,000 feels about right compared to other things that are punishable by other types of fine.
So there's a consistency there in relation to that. Do you think it's a strong enough, Mr. Pryor, a strong enough incentive to comply? And are there any affordability concerns?
If I give you my answer based on my typical client base, would they want to avoid a £5,000 fine? Yes, they would.
I think we all would, yes. Yeah. We'll leave it at that. Dr. Robbie?
I don't think that that's a substantive disincentive. So it could just be seen as the cost of doing business. And if you want to avoid preparing a land management plan, you could just pay £5,000.
Which we've had other evidence and written evidence in relation to that. So we've got a kind of spectrum of evidence there. Now, I did mention cross-compliance, especially from the Land Commission, about the possibility of some of that kicking in, so it might not just be £5,000, but just for precision, I want to read the question I have in front of me here. The consultation of the bill proposed that the outcome of any investigation into a breach could be taken into account in any subsequent public interest test, and that there could be additional conditions attached to receipt of public funds, such as registration in the Land Register, and if in receipt of subsidies, registration and liability for UK EU tax. None of these proposals have been brought forward in the bill. I'm going to roll two questions together here for time constraints, convener, I think. What do you think the reasons for these not being included are? Are there any legal difficulties in doing so? And would these provide a greater range of remedies to ensure compliance? Because what we heard last week was cross-compliance penalties could be a lot more substantial than £5,000. Mm. So I've thrown a lot of things together there. Mr. McLeod, do you may want to comment first? That would be really helpful.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of sense in linking it to cross-compliance. So if the state on one hand is paying out money to farmers or to state owners to do something, that's good. But if that person is not really fulfilling their contract and other things that the state requires them to do, and not getting public money makes a lot of sense. I think that there will be an irony if you delve into that more deeply, and I suspect this isn't for today. It's whether the underlying land management practices that give rise to cross-compliance issues are compatible with net zero and the climate emergency and all the rest of it. So you may find that money is paid out to farmers, estate owners, to do things that perhaps may not be completely compliant with the principles of the bill. But in principle, I see the logic in connecting the two.
And would you want to see more in the bill in relation to that, Mr. McLeod?
I think if the government, if the committee are concerned that it doesn't have enough teeth, I think there's a logical... I mean, I personally look at this and, again, think about my client base, and based on that, I'd be pretty relaxed about this, because I think you'll find most landowners are already doing most of the things that we think the land management plans will require. I thought there was very useful evidence from the Tenant Farming Commissioner last session when he was asked about whether he thought he needed more teeth and more enforcement powers, etc., etc., and he didn't seem terribly enthusiastic about that. So I think you'll find a pretty high degree of compliance across the country.
Thank you. Mr. Cahoon, do you have anything to add?
I think I'm going to return to my no comment.
Which is fine. I'm trying to scrutinise, but I'm trying to force you to answer something that you're not in a position to answer.
It's not an area of practice that faculty really is involved with.
Gail, what? Are you in a similar position? Or?
It's not something that we discussed in full in terms of our response, but more than happy to take it away and come back with further written evidence if you'd like.
Really helpful. Thank you. Dr. Robbie?
I think cross-compliance would be a really useful tool. I think when you're encouraging any change in behaviour, it's useful to have several options. And if there's a possibility of escalation, in a sense, I think that's also useful. Why it's not been included in the bill, I mean, it's maybe difficult to consider how you get everybody to communicate to ensure that cross-compliance actually works. but that's an internal administrative issue rather than anything else, I think, to the government. Why it's not been taken into account in the public interest test, I think, just because lotting is not what was originally imagined in a public interest test. I think it would also be quite challenging to consider lack of land management plans within the context of lotting, but it's currently drafted, but it's not beyond reason. But I would be very supportive of a range of sanctions, just so that there is a possibility of encouraging a change of behaviour to somebody who's not compliant.
Okay, that's helpful. And my final question is in relation to back onto the £5,000 non-compliance fine a little bit, and where and when that can be levied. I think the committee found there's a bit of lack of clarity, potentially in relation to the bill. Perhaps witnesses could help us. So, section 44B3, subsection C, requires the land management plan to be set out how the owner is complying or intends to comply with the obligations set out in the regulations. And section 44E allows specific persons to allege a breach of an obligation imposed by regulations under S44A. Is the drafting adequately clear to ensure there are obligations to produce both and comply with land management plans? I mean, for myself, that sounds a little bit like gobbledygook. What I really want to know is, I'd rather no one is being fined, because people just comply and we have good practice and it's all positive, of course, but can £5,000 be fined for not producing a land management plan, and then later down the line one appears, if they're not complying with it, another £5,000 can be levied? I'd also be keen to know whether £5,000 can be levied more than once, because if you don't comply with a land management plan and you're fined £5,000 and 3 months pass and you're still not complying with it, is it then another £5,000? So we're trying to grapple a little bit. We'll ask the government, of course, about what the clarity is and how these things may or may not operate. Mr McLeod, are you able to offer some assistance in relation to that?
Yeah, so just on your first point, I had to do the exact same second read when I was looking at the bill. So it talks in 44A, it's the Scottish Ministers, this is paragraph one, may by regulations impose obligations. So it's the regulations that impose the obligations, and then 44B talks about the breach of the obligations. So it's a good point, but I think that the drafting has covered it. In relation to the second point, so I don't think that a landowner could be fined more than once for the same breach, but I suspect the legislation would allow the Commissioner to keep on fining an owner for different breaches of the land management plan and the obligations that are arising from that. That would be my interpretation of the...
Okay, well, look at it, Dr. Robbie. This makes it Dr. Robbie and next, but this does sound if the Commissioner gives one breach for non-compliance across the whole swathe of obligations of the land management plan, they can't return to fine a second time, where individual aspects can be subject to each individual £5,000 fine. Dr. Robbie, what's your kind of take on this?
Yeah, so I think it's difficult, but I think it also depends what is in the regulations. So I think what 44B says is that a land manager has to make a plan, has to ensure there's engagement, and then that needs to be reviewed. That those are kind of what the regulations must, almost as a minimum, require. They could then say that there's obligations to comply with certain things, but if the owner, it's not clear because the regulations are not there, okay, as to whether there would be an individual obligation to reach a particular goal, and then if the landowner didn't do that, there could be a fine for that non-compliance. It's possible, with how it's drafted, that as long as they publish the plan, then that obligation is met.
I love it when people of a kind of legal background start looking at each other to see. Fergus Cahoon and Gail Watt have not had the opportunity to comment. Gail, do you want to add anything?
We need more information in terms of the regulations. And one point which was also raised by our members was, again, I feel like I keep repeating myself, but overlap and duplication with other avenues of recourse that might be open.
You should keep making that point, the point the members gave you. Of course you should. Fergus, go ahead.
I sort of associate myself with what Gail has said, that there's a lack of information at this stage. We can't really comment on what the breaches might be or might look like, because the legislation leaves the obligations to secondary legislation to specify. We did, in preparing our response, question whether leaving quite substantial obligations on landowners to imposition by secondary obligations was desirable or appropriate, but that's really a separate issue.
Okay, that's fine. And the last thing I want to ask, I know the Convener's got a line of questioning in this area, is I was a wee bit surprised to see some written evidence where there were concerns raised about the costs of developing a land management plan. I think Mr McLeod spoke about a lot of responsible landowners, quite frankly, getting on doing it just now without the need for legislation, so about an administrative burden. I mean, back if it said it's 3,000 hectares, I wouldn't have thought, but then I'm asking, I don't know. I would have assumed that's a dangerous thing I know in life, that it wouldn't be that burdensome or that costly in the greater scheme of things. So are there concerns any of the witnesses have in relation to the administrative burdens and the costs of relation to this? Because it's important to a balance for you as a committee, and we get some of that on the record here this morning. Maybe Mr McLeod?
So the difficulty answering that is we don't know what the regulations are going to say. So they could be very detailed, they could be very long, they could be very short. It could be satisfied in 2 pages. It may require 20. I'm guessing that there will be quite a bit of detail required. And if you are asked to prepare something, and if you are under pain of a fine if you don't do it, I think most responsible landowners will take time to do it. They've got to review it. They've got to disclose quite a lot of information in the plans. So I think, yes, I would be thinking that the costs of complying with this are more than just a rounding error. I think they will be quite significant.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments from witnesses in relation to this? I would single anyone out. Any other? Dr. Robbie, I see you looking over.
I think that there could be other elements that could be included in the land management plans. I think it's wonderful that there's commitments, or you have to explain increasing or sustaining biodiversity, adapting to climate change. Other things, if we're looking at community impacts, about fulfilling the human rights of the population, other considerations could be put into these plans, I think.
A little bit more about whether or not I'm really sorry for cutting across you, but it's probably my lack of articulation with the question. So some witnesses in written evidence might think it's burdensome to do the community consultation and to consider biodiversity and net zero and the cost of preparing the plan. Dr. Robbie, there's more opportunity for what could be in the plan, but what others would say, and I'm generally supportive of the things you're saying, Dr. Robbie, but others might contend the more we ask them to do, the more burdensome and costly it could become. Have you got any thoughts in relation to that?
I think it is, I understand it's a burdensome, but the purpose of land reform is to tackle negative consequences, social and environmental consequences of large-scale land ownership. So more requirements on landowners in order to try and tackle those negative consequences, I don't think is a bad thing as long as they're effective.
Okay, so doing the right thing is not burdensome, Dr. Robbie, I think might be the point you're making. Fergus Cahoon or Gail Watt, do you have anything to add? And I'll bow out of my line of questioning at this point. You'll be glad to hear.
No, thank you.
There has to be a clear expectation of what's to be included in the land management plan in order to guide people to understand their responsibilities and guide their conduct. The financial memorandum wasn't available at the time that we had submitted our response, and I'll leave that at that, but I have read it. As Jill said, there's a multiplicity of rights affecting everybody's land, and Scotland is very unique in that sense, with crofters, graziers, agricultural tenants, residential tenants, commercial tenants, who could all be within that 3,000 hectareage limit. But the society wants to see whatever's taken forward here, that it's taken forward in the principle of transparency, engagement and the public interest.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm just going to push on a little bit on management plans. Don, I think you said that they weren't rounding errors when it came to the cost of drawing it up. So let's just say you've got a medium to large side estate, you've got three communities on it, you go out and consult with them, get their input, draw up the management plan, which probably for landowners is probably 20 years rather than 5 years, because nothing happens in 5 years. Is a cost of 25k unreasonable for that?
Yeah, I mean, instinctively, it's so hard to say, but yeah, I could see if someone's doing it properly and they are doing the community engagement, which is important, and they're talking to other stakeholders, also important, that takes time, and then they've got to write it down. And there is, in some ways, quite a lot covered in terms of the framework of the plans in 44B. I could see it being that kind of level. That's just an instinctive shooting from the hip view.
OK. So, when it comes to natural capital, for example, it would be quite detailed, wouldn't it, if you were buying an estate for natural capital and you were having to draw up a management plan. It would probably have the planting schemes on a year-by-year basis based around and the harvesting scheme, which is going to be quite complex. Jill, you sort of nodded. I mean, it's, What I'm trying to get to is it's not just something that's going to happen overnight. No. I mean, for goodness sake, the state bought Glen Prosen 2 years ago and still hasn't come up with a management plan for it, and that was only 3,000 hectares. Mm-hmm. So it's not going to happen overnight, is it?
No.
Okay, and talk about the expectation, community input. So there's consultation that goes on, and one of the community inputs, for example, is to create a, mountain bike track from A to B. That's what the community would like to see, because it would give them some input into a local business. And that's put into the management plan. Who's going to pay for that? Jill, do you want to say, does funding have to go in the management plan? Is it all going to be down to the landowner to fund it all if the community want it?
I suppose the process of making the plan allows those discussions to take place. And just because the community wants something doesn't necessarily mean they're going to get it, right? But there is a method in which, or a forum in which, those discussions could be had. And they might not get, for example, exactly what they want, but there is a process of discussion that allows a compromise in that context. And I think that that's positive and beneficial. It can create conflicts, but I also don't necessarily think that that's a negative thing, as long as there's a process of working it out.
So you think expectation can be managed if the communities had an input, that it might not be deliverable because there aren't the funds to do it?
Yes.
Despite the fact that it's a big landowner that owns it?
Yes, I mean, yes. If everybody's around the table and there are processes of being able to discuss this, or even are there partnerships that could be had with various parties that are affected by this in order to provide the facility, for example?
Don, you put your hand up. You want to
I think that touches on what, to my mind, is quite an important point in the drafting. And to my mind, it's not clear whether the bill and the regulations are going to require positive or different changes in land management in order to comply. So, for example, if I take the statement that the plan is to include how the owner is managing or intends to manage the land in a way that contributes towards net zero climate change and all the rest of it, that, to my mind, is very unclear. Can the landowner say, well, what steps are you taking? And an extreme example, well, none. That wouldn't happen, because so many now are doing that. But is that going to be allowed, or is it going to be, you must say what you are doing to contribute towards this, i.e. imposing a positive obligation on the author of the land management plan to do something? And I think that's something quite different from what I think the government is possibly intending. But that's a...
I mean, on my reading of it, I was concerned the government might come along if somebody bought something for a hill farm and told them to take all the sheep off the hill because it doesn't contribute to net zero. Would that concern you?
Yes. So if you bought a hill farm to keep it as a hill farm, and then you come to your land management plan and you're asked, you come to a section that says, how are you managing or intends to manage the land in a way that contributes towards net zero, you might have a problem. So is the legislation then going to require you to do something different, or will it be okay to say, I've been asked this question and actually I'm not, or I can't?
I mean, what's not clear to me is that if you get a 365 calving day average, if you've got cattle, that you're reducing the amount of barren periods of cattle, whether that would be sufficient to be proving you're getting to net zero. And you know, if you're lambing percentage is up above 100%, you know, is that sufficient because you're making sure that you're not carrying excess animals? I don't know. It's unclear to me. Douglas, you want to ask a question?
Yes. Briefly, Convener, and it's looking at the written submission from Mr. McLeod. It's about, you've said in here that there may be some confidential and commercially sensitive information that you might not want to put in a plan. Can you give us some examples of what that might be?
So in relation to land management plans, the issue is that you have to say when you plan to sell the property. And I think that's private information. And there may be consequences of saying when you plan to sell the property. So, as I'm sure the committee knows, trying to find staff for estates is very difficult. and you have a requirement for a new stocker, and the stocker checks your plan and sees that you intend to sell it within 5 years, he's probably not going to be terribly interested in staying or going to an estate like that when the owner is planning to go. It could have a market distorting effect. Somebody could look at the plans and say, well, I know in this glen, in this region, I know that the plan is this estate will come on the market then, this estate will come on the market then, and this big farm will come on the market then. Now, these things aren't cast iron, but I think it's very private information, and I don't think that should be part of the plan.
So is it only the sale date that you would have an issue with, or is it really what people want to do with the land?
I think all the other things in terms of the list as concepts, that's all fair enough. But I think having to disclose when you plan to sell your property, I think that crosses a line.
Okay. Thank you, Cabina itself.
Just before we leave that and go to Monica, who's got a supplementary, could you just clarify that you don't expect these management plans to include financial information? Do you expect it to say how much it costs to run an estate? Might be quite interesting. Might be quite frightening. Jill, do you want to answer that?
In relation to natural capital projects, it would be interesting in relation to the amount of profits being made and the potential percentage that is predicted to be put into community benefit funds, for example.
So you would like to see the entire cash flow of it?
No, I wouldn't like to see the entire cash flow, because I think those kind of things are getting into very sensitive information. But I do also understand that there's a lot of expense involved in running estates, and that also shouldn't be underestimated. But the for disclosure of the level of profits being made from natural capital would be very interesting to see.
Well, might put them off, or it might encourage them. Monica, you've got some questions.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, I'd like to bring us back to net zero, because that was starting to sound like an interesting discussion. So what we do know is that land and land use are Scotland's biggest emitters of greenhouse gases. So my question is, do the owners of large land holdings have a moral and societal responsibility to promote net zero and climate change measures? And if we agree on that point, and I'm now looking at Mr. McLeod in particular, but is it reasonable to accept that there should be obligations on the biggest emitters to reduce their emissions? And if so, how could the bill be strengthened and improved in that area?
Yeah, no, absolutely agree. In terms of if you're a big polluter, you should pay, and that happens in terms of the mandatory carbon market already, for fair enough reasons. If we're dealing with the voluntary carbon market, if there are opportunities, and I guess here we are talking about degraded peatlands, which do emit, then yeah, I think landowners are incentivised and are doing this. They really are doing it. They are doing their peatland restoration projects enthusiastically, which has the effect of reducing carbon leakage, biodiversity improvements and all the rest of it. So I think you'll find huge excitement in the sector about this.
And is there scope to do more?
Yeah, I think there is scope to do more. I think the odd thing is that the government have cut the funding to do it. So that is a problem. And that's where it maybe comes back to the earlier question in terms of inward investment. If the government want this to happen, and for it to happen realistically, sustainably, achievably, and all the rest of it, the money's got to come from somewhere. So if the government aren't going to provide as much for tree planting or peatland restoration, then I think it's inevitable that it's going to come from somewhere else.
Okay, we may return to that if there's time. Dr. Robbie.
Yes, I do think there is a moral responsibility on large-scale landowners to contribute to tackling the climate and biodiversity crises. I think that this is a step in the right direction in terms of land management plans, and there is a process of land reform, I think, that we are going through. That we had the Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement that provided a vision, and this is getting further into ensuring compliance of large-scale land owners to these responsibilities. I think you have to balance it to be the obligations to be realistic in order to make sure there is compliance. And that's the tricky balance I think we're all involved in. Otherwise, you lose the room. and then you'll just get people who are not actually fulfilling their obligations.
Thank you.
Trying to do that at the pace and scale that is required is almost impossible, I think.
Thank you. And perhaps Fergus Cahoon could build on that point about balance and where we might need to see more clarity in the bill.
I cannot, on behalf of the faculty, take a position on whether owners have a moral obligation to do anything. Having said that, finding a balance between the rights of owners and the responsibilities of owners is something which I suppose has to be if anything at all, it has to be workable. Otherwise, it will just end up in a dispute in court. And how exactly that balance is found is for people better qualified than I am to say. I suppose, but it is, I would certainly say, very important to find that balance, yeah. Because otherwise, the legislation will end up mm-hmm. not achieving the goals that yeah. it wants to, or achieving them only by lining the pockets of individuals like me.
Thank you. I don't want to push you beyond your remit today in terms of the mandate that you have, but to go back to Don McLeod's point about the polluter should pay, would it be fair to say that if we are looking at responsibilities and obligations, that there should be an evidence base in terms of the impact of certain activities? So is it making sure that there's clarity around impact and what should be an appropriate form of compensation or mitigation? Is that a better way to look at it, perhaps?
I don't think I can really. I don't think I can.
That's
really
okay.
Say
there's
much
nothing more to add. I'll
Sorry.
Move along to Gail Watt.
Again, the society takes the same position with the faculty when it comes to moral obligations. But what I would say, and as we put as part of our submission on this, is that there does need to be careful consideration, again, to overlaps with existing legislation, with existing rights, as Dawn has said, the existing environmental polluter pays principles. And again, ensuring that there's no duplication or loopholes or bear traps falling in between all of these, because that's going to be the best way to ensure compliance, making sure everything is straightforward.
I think on that point that Gail Watt raises, which I know came up in a discussion with Bob Doris earlier on, is that a wider concern right now that perhaps government is doing too much all at once, that we've got lots of different legislation coming through and strategy and policy, but that cohesive approach is perhaps getting lost somewhere in all of that process? Is that something you can comment on today, or any advice that you could give to us as members as we try to scrutinise this at times quite busy landscape of government activity?
It's not something that I can comment on behalf of okay. the society today, but we are more than happy to take that away and respond to you with in writing on that. As I have said today, and as you've mentioned as well just now, the level of movement in legislation in this sector is immense and has been for quite some time now. And unless that is looked at in a collaborative and cohesive manner, there will be unintended consequences. And that is our concern, not just for members of the society, but for everybody who is going to be affected by this legislation and subsequent.
Thank you for that point and the offer to provide further advice. Thank you, Convener.
Now, we are, as always in this committee, up against a time constraint. So I'm going to push people to quick questions, quick answers, where possible. Mark, I think you've got a that you want to come.
Yeah, quickly, Convener. I'm just struck by, you know, how do you discharge that obligation on climate? Perhaps if I could ask Mr. McLeod, I mean, you'll be aware that the Scottish Government is looking at a carbon land tax. Is that perhaps not the best way, create a mechanism, financial incentive? You say a lot of your clients are, you know, desperately wanting to move forward on investment in this area. Would that be an appropriate way forward? Is that something that could then go into the land management plans about how landowners are then meeting their obligations under a carbon land tax?
Yes, so I'm aware of various industry voices who would push for a carbon land tax. I think the general consensus is that any kind of land tax is just immensely complicated. So I was part of a group with the Land Commission 2 or 3 years ago where we looked at land taxation, and I can maybe dig it out and send it to the clerk, but I'm pretty sure the conclusion of that group was that land value taxes were just too complicated. But I will check that, if that's okay, and send it to the clerk, because that was quite interesting on that particular point.
Dr. Robbie?
I am supportive of a carbon land tax. I think that the current ways in which we are trying to incentivize change in relation to net zero, for example, is through incentives. But that often results in more resources being channeled to people who already have lots of resources. So if we acknowledge the kind of distributive question behind all of this, which land reform is intended to really tackle, is that there are certain people, a few people in Scotland with a lot of the resources. And in that context, I think also the tool of a tax would be useful.
Okay, so it's wealth in its broadest sense, not just land ownership, but what the land generates as well. Back to you, Convener.
Okay, some quickfire questions before we come back to Monica. So, and I fear they're going to be at Don and Jill. So, quickfire questions. You said community right to buy in this bill, fearfully complex. We haven't sorted out the previous one. Does this bill make sense on community right to buy, or would you change it?
Who do you want to answer?
Jill.
I don't think that this is going to change anything. I would be so surprised if there's a community that is able to use this new process. Basically, there's 40 days to make a late application, which I don't think anything can get done in 40 days. I don't know about anybody else, but it's just too hard.
Could the government issue a letter recognising a community in 40 days? The average is 70, isn't it?
Yes, I hear that it's to at least 2 months at the moment. So I just don't think that that's useful. It's also an additional, very complicated route. And for me, sitting down and trying to understand what all the timescales was hard. And, you know, I'm teaching law at the University of Glasgow. I don't know if I should be saying that, but it's really hard. So your person on the street who wants to buy a piece of land and gets an email that has some sort of information about how they navigate the process, I don't think they'll be able to within the timescales.
And Don, was it a walk in the park for you? Did you understand it?
It's mind-boggling. It's absolutely mind-boggling. So I read the bill yesterday again from beginning to end, part one, in preparation for this. It's just so complicated. There's one section of the bill, I will confess, I've read it 50 times. I do not understand what it means, and it's the 50 hectare bit when you're doing lotting. I don't know what it means, and that's very serious. And if you add in the fact that communities can do their own lotting at the moment by triggering a right to buy, by registering a right to buy, and if they really want to make a community thing happen, they can get going now, they can form their community body, they can really do this. I think that both lotting and the prior notification are just unnecessary. The prior notification thing in particular, it just seems so bizarre that if somebody wants to sell, the example I've used before is someone in the village phones the estate office and says, my greenhouse has been on estate land for 30 years, I need to buy 0.2 hectares or 0.2 acres. That happens all the time in estate conveyancing. Under this, the owner can take no, can't discuss the proposal with the concerned resident because they've got to tell the government first. The government have to broadcast this to the nation, presuming a website. They've got to tell the local authority, they've got to tell the community council, all for this piece of ground for somebody to rectify their title anomaly with their greenhouse. It's totally unworkable.
Sorry, just so I've got that right. So you want to sell a little plot, if you're a large holding, to a builder to build a couple of houses for the local community. Is your understanding of the bill that you'd have to lot the whole estate and go through the prior notification process?
No. So if it's small enough, you don't have to do lotting. You just have to do prior notification. But in that scenario, you could not talk to the builder. You could not talk to the person in the community who wants to buy the house. You could say nothing to them. You can take no steps to progress a sale. The first person you phone is the government.
So you phone the government to tell them you want to build a couple of houses on a small plot?
Yeah.
And then you can start talking to people?
Yes, I think
after
that's
70
right.
days.
But the point at which you're obliged to talk to the government, you know nothing, because you haven't been able to talk to the builder, and you haven't been able to talk to the person who wants to buy the plots. You can do absolutely nothing, no steps in relation to a sale if you're 1,000 hectares and more without going through the prior notification process.
Okay, sounds interesting. I think we're going to come on to lotting, so I think that that will be dealt with. Just a very quick-fire question, and then Bob wants a quick-fire question, I hope. Yeah. Me first.
Not as quick.
My question is, too complex is what you're saying. We could make it easier. Do you think we need to completely rewrite this section on registration? It seems every 10 years we do something different and we never seem to get it right.
On the prior notification?
Yeah, and all that bit, the community right to buy.
I think that the good thing about prior notification is that it avoids, or it's trying to avoid, the situation where there are private sales going on, where there... and I think that this is, again, exacerbated because of natural capital markets, where there are just a few buyers which are phoned up, and it's that closed group of people who know about the sale. So I think that that is a useful part. But the other part, in terms of an accelerated process and giving communities an additional extended, highly complex procedure, I don't think will benefit the communities in the way that's intended.
Don, do you want to answer very quickly, or have you sufficiently?
Yeah, no, I don't think the prior notification process is necessary at all, because we already have rights to buy, and I think if there's work to be done, which there probably is, I think the work should be on looking at the rights to buy, how they work, are they meaningful? Because at the moment, the evidence is that they're just not, because no one is really registering. And the whole point about this legislation, it really puts a kind of a trumpet blast on top of the rights to buy, so that everyone knows a sale is about to happen. But if the fundamental rights to buy themselves don't appear to be working in the way that benefit communities, then there's something not quite right there.
Okay, for fear of repeating myself, there seems to be a bit dichotomy here that the government wants to buy Glenprozen and not tell the Parliament for 3 months after they bought it. And if this legislation was in, they wouldn't have got away with it. Bob?
I'm not sure what the government did or didn't get away with, but I'll stick to the bill that we're scrutinising. Can I just check a very brief supplementary, and can I link some of this back to land management plans? The consultation responsibilities as part of land management plans, okay, at 3,000 hectares at the moment, but the case was made for 1,000 hectares, is one of the ways to soften the prior notification element, not to say that landowners should be discussing with communities the community right to buy framework as part of that consultation process in itself. And if that's part of the land management plan, then hopefully communities are empowered
and would register an interest anyway, irrespective of whether the land was coming up for sale or not. Is there maybe look at this with the wrong end of the lens a little bit, Dr. Robbie?
No, I mean, in section, clause 44C, there is an owner is to give reasonable consideration of the community body to lease land, but not to sell. So there could be a possibility of how has the owner considered diversification in terms of diversification of ownership and reasonable request from a community body to purchase parcels of land.
As also. Part of the land management plan consultation process?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Don McLeod, do you have any views on that?
So just on Jill's point, so at the moment, so if a community were interested in buying those parcels, what they'd do is they'd register a right to buy under the Sustainable Development Right to Buy. Now, they could force the landowner to sell those plots even although the landowner does not want to sell. So that's one tool that's already there. Or they could register a community right to buy in those parcels and wait until the landowner takes steps to sell. And I think that highlights the point that the utility of the rights to buy is the thing to focus on here.
But you know, there's a scope within land management plan regulations to see that consultation process with the communities is an opportunity to discuss with communities what their rights actually are, because not every community will be aware of what their rights are or have organised in such a fashion. Should that be part of that discourse during that consultation process? Mm-hmm.
Yes, I mean, I think if that's the policy objective, looking at it from that way is a much better starting point than what we have at the moment.
Right, thank you.
Thanks very much. Now, listen, I said we were up against it time-wise. I want to get through part one of the bill in the next 11 minutes. So, Monica and Douglas, Monica first and then Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. So I wanted to cover off lotting, but quite a bit has been said already on lotting, and we have written submissions that are helpful. In terms of the criteria, I wanted to ask, and again, not everyone needs to answer, I appreciate maybe Fergus might set this one out. Are there criteria beyond scale that might be appropriate, and what would the advantages or disadvantages of these be? We know about the 1,000 hectare threshold. I don't know who wants to start on that. I think Jill?
So, yes, I think that there are possibilities for other criteria which are not just scale. I think that the evidence in relation to the problems of concentration of ownership can be very nuanced in a local environment or situation. So if there were additional criteria which talked about, I think the Scottish Land Commission discussed local monopolies, for example, where a landowner had the majority of local employment in the area or owned crucial community facilities such as jetties and petrol stations and, you know, this kind of stuff that resulted in the concentration of power of crucial resources. It could also include ecosystems, for example. I think that the threshold, in a way, is trying to be simple, but doesn't quite even reach that, and also doesn't reflect where there can be that sense of concentration of power. One way I thought of dealing with this is to almost map concentration zones, that we've had repopulation zones, for example, which would be an extra layer that could even be determined, for example, through the planning system, where there is that concentration of power due to the ownership of facilities.
Thank you. Anybody else on that question?
So I'm sure the committee is well versed in the distinction between scale and concentration. So in Caithness, a large landholder owning 2 acres could be very inconsequential. And on the outskirts of Pennycook, the farmer who has a 400-acre farm holding 2 acres next to the village could be very, very consequential. And I think the lotting tool is far too blunt. It may catch some things, but it probably wouldn't catch a lot. So I think it focuses on the wrong thing and it misses the point of distinguishing between scale on the one hand and concentration on the other.
Thank you. And I know that local context has come up already and the role of ministers in making decisions, but how might the process be improved to take account of local context? And is it appropriate that ministers make the decision? Is there another kind of way this could be done more proportionately?
Can I just jump on that point?
Yeah.
And this is quite a niche point, and I'll come on to a more general point in a moment. There's a real issue with the fact that one of the biggest landowners in the country is the Scottish Government. How are they going to make lotting work? So they ask themselves for a lotting decision. They speak to their own appointed commissioner for advice. It doesn't work. They ask themselves for a review of the lotting. They consider themselves whether they might buy it, and then they appoint their own valuer. That could stink. And that has got conflict written all over it. And I think in the context of the government being a very large landholder, that's a real problem.
Does anyone in the panel disagree with Dawn on that point he's just made? Or agree? Neutral? Silence. OK, if I maybe can come back to Fergus, because in your written submission, the faculty set out... and I've lost my notes now, but it's the part about provision for right of appeal to the Court of Session against a lotting decision. And the submission is going to highlight that appeals ordinarily go to the Lands Tribunal or the Land Court, but under this process, they go directly to the Court of Session, which may produce procedural difficulties. Would you be able to explain a bit more to the committee about that?
Yes, I mean, ultimately, there are four potential options for who you could direct, or four obvious options where you could direct an appeal to. And that would be the sheriff, so the traditional option, not often used these days, the Lands Tribunal, the Land Court, and the Court of Session. The bill has chosen the Court of Session. It wasn't particularly clear to us why. The Lands Tribunal might be thought to be the more obvious choice. Equally, the Lands Tribunal is by definition an expert tribunal, and if you want, as the bill does explicitly provide for in... I don't have the section. 44... Oh, I'll find it. It specifically provides that an appeal, 67U, the appeal should be based on an error of fact or law, or is unreasonable. So we're not talking about a rehearing or taking a new decision to substitute for the decision that the ministers have taken. The Lands Tribunal would be the place that you would have the appeal to if you did want the tribunal to be taking a fresh decision, rather than simply acting as a control to make sure that the decision maker had got the law right. So there's nothing objectionable about using the Court of Session as your appeal route. If you do want it to be restricted to a review of whether the decision maker has understood the law and the facts, rather than taking a fresh decision. We have two points to make if the Court of Session is going to be the appropriate appeal route. The first is that 28 days is an awfully short time to decide whether to appeal. The standard for a statutory appeal is 6 weeks, and if you're looking at a judicial review, the standard is 3 months, and judicial reviews have the ability to extend that period if it's appropriate to do so in the circumstances. A lotting decision probably would be a pretty complex thing to be analysing. There would be, before you could lodge an appeal, you would need to be collecting expert evidence and working out exactly what it was that you objected to. 28 days is quite a short timescale to be doing that in. The second is that statutory appeals to the quarter session go to the inner house invariably. That's the quarter session sitting as an appeal court, three judges. There's very limited ability to hear evidence in that, which might sometimes be relevant to an appeal like this. And it's also a more expensive procedure and a slower procedure than you might get under, for example, judicial review or an appeal to the Lands Tribunal. If you wanted to keep it as an appeal to, or keeping it being subject to the jurisdiction of the Court of Session, then judicial review might actually be a more sensible way of reviewing decisions like this.
Thank you. That's helpful. Be interested to hear how others respond to that as well, including the government's view.
Okay. Thank you. Douglas, I think you're...
Yeah, yes, I'm just going to ask quickly on the establishment of the Land and Communities Commissioner. I guess I'll probably wrap all my questions together, convener, just for sort of time. The first bit is, you know, do you think it's appropriate that landowners are disqualified from that role? And what further power should the Commissioner have in relation to supporting and enforcing the measures relating to community engagement and land management plans? And also to Mr McLeod, you seem to suggest that... the role shouldn't be responsible for investigating and enforcing breaches of community engagement regulations. Maybe just to get a bit of context around that also.
So I think the ban on large land holders, I think it's actually a bit bizarre, and no other appointment in the Commission is subject to the same exclusion. And I think there are many large land holders in Scotland who would actually be very good as the Land and Communities Commissioner, and just because they are large landholders doesn't mean that they always think that large landholding is the only way or against community ownership or anything like that. So I think there's a real missed opportunity.
But would there not be a sort of conflict of interest if they... I guess that would be the reason why it would be put in.
I think it's too much to assume just because you own an estate, you will then make poor decisions in relation to other land management situations. And I think there's a real mine of experience there that could be tapped and could be much better.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Anybody else got a comment on that exclusion? Or?
I'm supportive of that exclusion. It makes sense to me. I suppose the purpose of the Land and Communities Commissioner is to investigate where there are problems with large-scale landholders. And so the exclusion makes sense. In terms of other functions or powers, I think the ability of the Commissioner to initiate their own investigations would also be helpful. I think is the way that it's drafted at the moment, there needs to be a complaint to the Commissioner from a defined set of bodies. But if they were able to initiate their own investigation, I think that would be useful.
Okay. Mr. McLeod, maybe come back to you on that point about the Commissioner having the powers for investigating and enforcing breaches. You seem to be against that.
So I think that the function of the Land Commissioner, I guess this is more for them to speak about, it's more in relation to policy and good practice and engagement, which they do an excellent job at. It seems strange that they are given a kind of quasi-judicial function in addition to that. Will that change the dynamic in the Land Commission? I think it's possible. And I think I'm right in saying that the new Land and Communities Commissioner would be the only person within the Land Commission who would have the power to issue fines. I think that's right, but I can double check it if necessary. And that, to me, doesn't sit very comfortably with them and with all the good work that they are doing in other ways.
So do you think it almost takes it from a... I'm not trying to put words into your mouth... an organisation that's obviously advising, helping landowners to then suddenly being almost the policeman as well, and that maybe
exactly. And I think the government should reflect on the experience of the Tenant Farming Commissioner, who has in some ways in the face of it pretty limited powers, but has done a very effective job. in improving things and in discharging his functions. So if he doesn't or she doesn't need a fine issuing power, then is it really logical that there's a colleague in the Land Commission that can do that? And that's not back to the point about whether a fine is right or not. It's just, is that the appropriate place to be doing it? I'm not sure it is.
Okay. Any other comments on the commissioner role? Or?
Well, there have been calls for the tenant farmer commissioner to also have further powers. So I appreciate that the work of that the farming commissioner has, I think, been quite well received. But to back up the good practice codes with further penalties is also something that other people have suggested.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Thanks,
Gavin. I'm going to stop you there because I've broken my own deadline and I'm under a little bit of pressure from my deputy convener to get a final question into one person. So I'm going to move to Ben for the final question.
Thank you, convener. Well, this is, if I may, just for the subjective question, so for Dr. Robbie and Mr. McLeod. Earlier we talked about the transfer test. The Scottish Government consulted previously on a public interest test as well, and I just wondered if you had any views on the public interest test and whether there would be merit in amending the bill to include one.
I think that the criteria in Clause 67N is really quite weak. If you compare it with the other community rights to buy criteria, for example, which are much more extensive and require many more factors to be taken into account, I think there should be more detail about that, about the test that is to be taken into account. There's also no restriction on the buyer, and that's my fear of what will be the implications of lotting in this context. So I think the public interest test was much more concerned with not only who's selling but also who's buying, whereas this will potentially free up new land for new purchasers, but we don't know what will then happen. And with the number of pressures on land in Scotland, I'm not sure we can allow that to happen.
So you think a public interest test would be a good addition?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And Mr. McLeod?
So I very much agree with Jill that 67N is weak, and there's no requirement for the lotting to be directed towards community ownership. So all that could happen is you have lots and you replicate private ownership time after time, each lot. And I think that's the major weakness in terms of what the policy, the stated policy aim is. I don't think a public interest test is the way to do it because it's temporary in terms of at the point of purchase, who is this person wanting to buy and what are they going to do, and opens up a very complicated industry of regulation. So I think looking at it the other way, in terms of looking at land management plans, looking at cross-compliance, looking at the land rights and responsibilities statement, looking at the planning system, looking at enforcing environmental law, I think that's the way to achieve the policy objectives rather than a very blunt instrument of a public interest test.
So we don't want to consider the public interest of somebody buying land in Scotland?
Can I ask what you mean by that?
Well, sorry, I didn't mean to put words in your mouth, and I didn't mean to question your position in terms of wanting to see land well used in Scotland. I didn't mean to insinuate otherwise. I think what interests me about the public interest test is that it goes back to that issue I raised in my first question, which is that there is a view that many hold in Scotland that land is not being well used at present. And I include urban Scotland in that. Mm-hmm. And the public interest test has the potential, some have argued in evidence to us, to help in better utilisation of land, not just in an agricultural setting, in a rural setting, in an island setting, but also in an urban setting.
Yeah, so I think, and hopefully not being too repetitive, but I would look at it the other way in terms of the tools that are already there in the rights to buy. They're hugely powerful. but no one is taking advantage of them. So if someone is going after, let's use natural capital, and if that's not regarded as being positive, can the community, could they force the sale of some land? They could. Could they have a preemptive right to buy land as it becomes available for sale? Yes, they could. In the urban sphere, if there's a problematic and negligent landowner, can they force the sale of that right to buy? Then yes, they can. And I think that's where there's just a real underestimation of what communities can do that looks at it from their point of view rather than the point of view of a buyer.
Okay. I'll leave it at that, Convener, given the time constraints.
That brings us to the end of the first part, and I'm going to suspend the meeting. But before I do, can I just thank Jill and Don for the evidence that they've given this morning. I think, Fergus and Gail, you're staying put for the second section. Can I just say that the fact that this has taken so long probably proves the complexities of a 110-page bill. So I think there's always chance to feed in written comments as a result of today, and there's nothing to say that we won't ask you for further comment at future meetings, and other solicitors for that matter. So thank you very much, and I briefly suspend the meeting. Could I ask committee members to be back here for 11:15, please? Welcome back. Now we have a new member of the panel, Kirsten Donnell, and everyone else had a chance to say a little bit about what they did before. That's not a long explanation, but a short explanation of your experience in this field would be helpful.
Turk and Connell, specialising in rural property and agricultural matters. I am from an agricultural background, having grown up in a farm. I have a keen interest in agriculture. The majority of my clients are farmers, landowners, act for landlords and tenants, and my day-to-day work is within agricultural holdings and rural property.
Thank you. And Douglas Lumsden, I think you've got the first questions here.
Yes, absolutely. I'd just like to ask, in your view, would a non-binding model lease serve as a useful legal or practical purpose? And can you foresee any potential sort of legal issues around that? I don't know who wants to go first. Gail, would you?
Happy to go first. I just want to clarify what you mean by non-binding lease.
Just trying to work out myself.
I think what Mr. Lumsden means is the model lease for environmental purposes.
Right.
I think we're starting on the easy question,
that
we've never seen or whatever, and we're asking your opinion on it.
So,
it was just in case I'd missed something. So from the Society's position, we consider that there has to be greater clarity on the purpose and necessity for any new model of lease that needs to be introduced. There's already numerous forms of leases which can be adapted to include different types of uses, commercial considerations or practical points. And our view is that a simpler, more flexible approach would be to develop model clauses for insertion into relevant leases and lease forms, as opposed to having a brand new form of specific lease for this purpose.
Okay, Mr. Dunlop, would you have a view?
I don't think we need it, and the reason I don't think we need it is that it could simply be another form of a commercial lease. I think to try and intermix an environmental lease with agricultural holdings would complicate further what is already one of the most complicated areas of law. And I support the principle of an environmental lease, but it could simply be done under a commercial lease. So while I understand, I think, the reason behind the suggestion, I don't think it's needed.
OK. Mr. Cahoon, do you have a view on this?
We found Section 7 of the bill confusing in the sense that we didn't understand what it was for. I think we appreciate that that having a model lease for an environmental purpose might be a useful thing. Looking at the explanatory notes in the policy memorandum, we understood that it was not intended to fall within agricultural holdings legislation. At which point, as Mr. Dunlop says, it is fundamentally just a commercial lease. If the Scottish Government wants to prepare a draft commercial lease focused on environmental uses of land, we were unable to think of any reason that they couldn't do that already. At which point we questioned the purpose of Section 7. It's not something that parties would need to use. There's no proposition, as we understand it, to create a new statutory scheme and a new type of lease to stand alongside the existing agricultural holdings and whatnot. Whilst we have nothing to say really on the benefits of a special form of agricultural environmental lease, Section 7 as drafted seemed unnecessary.
But is it not helpful that the government have got that in? Or do you think it's just totally not required, as legislation already exists to to basically deal with this?
Well, legislation doesn't already exist to deal with environmental leases. That's true. That this is a new idea, certainly, but it doesn't seem to be one which requires legislation at this stage, because what's proposed is simply to draft what would be in law just an ordinary commercial lease.
Mm-hmm. I might just come in to say that. Okay. I don't think we need to be given a style of a lease. I think other incentives could be provided, maybe financial, to encourage people to enter into these kind of leases, but we don't, with the greatest respect, need the government to draft a model lease for us, I don't think.
So it's in terms of your point of view, it's just unnecessary, you know, that we can...
Yeah, we can do leases for land just now for this kind of purpose, so I just don't think we need it, and that's not to be disingenuous to the government and their aims of encouraging environmental activity, but I think it's another complexity to something that is already too complex.
Is this not a way of the government trying to encourage that environmental thing that we're all aiming for?
Yes, I assume that's the intention, but I don't think the government needs to produce a model lease for us to achieve that.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Now, Monica, I think you've got some questions.
Just one, Convener, on small land holdings. So from written submissions, I think both the Faculty of Advocates and Law Society of Scotland are, I think, broadly supportive for the small land holders provisions, but in Tyrconnell's...
Definitely supportive.
Okay, well, maybe let you expand on that in a moment. I think, in contrast with Tyrconnell, submission raises concerns. You disagree with the provisions. You state in your written evidence that the bill introduces some rights for small landholders from Croft tenure and others from 1991 Act tenure, which could result in unnecessary complexity. So can you expand on what rights you're referring to here? And then I'll come to Fergus.
Probably only to a small extent in that in 25 years I have never dealt with a small landholding. Colleagues have, and there's a colleague that fed into that particular part. I think the summary is that the feeling is they were dipping in and out of crofting and agricultural holdings legislation, and my own view, we should bring it into agricultural holdings just to simplify matters, and the extension of the Tenant Farming Commissioner into that. I have no difficulty with that, but I'm afraid I have very little personal experience of small landholders. I think there are only 50 or 60 in Scotland. I think they've got a page each in the bill.
Okay. The Faculty of Advocates raised a practical point about whether the opportunity should have been taken to codify the whole of the law on small landholdings rather than leaving some elements to the old Landholders Acts in place. But so I don't misrepresent the position, I'll come now to Fergus.
Yes, we're certainly broadly supportive of updating the law as it relates to small landholders, and you know, exactly how that's done is obviously a matter for the committee, and we don't have any comment to make on that. What we would observe, though, is that the small landholdings are now subject to a really quite complex statutory scheme. There are three main acts which govern them, the oldest of which is the Crofters Scotland Act 1886, which doesn't govern crofts anymore. There's also the Small Landholders Scotland Act 1911 and the Small Landholders and Agricultural Holdings Act 1931, and potentially also two acts relating to crofters' common grazings, which might apply to some small landholdings, and those date from 1891 and 1908. So three main acts and two others. And at this point, the fragmentation of the legislative scheme is probably a greater issue in working out how small landholdings work than the age of the legislation itself. The legislative provisions, broadly speaking, make sense, but they are scattered here and there, and the changes that are in the bill essentially add to the problem, because it would be adding a fourth main source of law relating to small landholdings, rather than either adding provisions to the existing legislation or codifying the existing legislation into a new scheme, which got rid of the 1886, 1911 and 1931 Acts. There's obviously a recognition that the legislative time and resource which will be required to do that might be disproportionate, considering the number of small landholdings which are left, and it doesn't look likely that any landlord, or indeed the Scottish Government, would create any more. So if this is the way that the rights of a small landholders can realistically be brought up to date, then fine. But we do express some concern over the complexity that this is going to create in an already complex area of law.
Okay, I think you've explained quite well that issue around fragmentation, but are you saying that given that some of these older acts would only apply in a small number of cases, is the government taking a pragmatic approach, or is there more that they could do to counter what you've described as fragmentation? Or sorry if I've not understood, because it is quite complex.
Well, there are three acts at the moment that you need to look to, and if this bill becomes law, there will be a fourth. And they all deal with different aspects of small landholders' tenure. If the aim is simply to bring things up to date and make sure that landholders have the same rights of succession as, for example, agricultural tenants, then this is a pragmatic way to do that. The concern that we would have is that it will be quite difficult for someone who is not a lawyer, and indeed it will be quite difficult for many lawyers who are not familiar with agricultural holdings legislation, to work out exactly what the rights and responsibilities of a small landholder is.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That is helpful. Thank you, Convener.
Now you've confused me. I'm totally confused. So I need to ask this question, because is it just simpler, as the Tenant Farmer Commissioner said, just shove them in with agricultural holdings legislation?
Well,
suggested.
Well, historically, they are crofts.
Yeah.
They came out of the crofters, the crofters holdings legislation, and there is currently provision for conversion of small landholdings into crofts in certain designated areas of Scotland. I don't know if any have actually been converted back into crofts. Most of the new rights which are granted to small landholders in the bill look more like agricultural holdings legislation than crofters legislation. From a legislative simplicity point, simply legislatively converting them to agricultural holdings might be a solution.
I think the concern is that some of the small holdings, and I think Grayson's right, there are very few of them, fall outside crofting counties, and the complexities of then making them part of crofts, it makes it easier to make them agricultural tenancies, so, or in line with the agricultural tenancy. It'd be interesting to see what other people say on that. Ben, I think you've got the next questions.
Thank you, Convener. Moving on to Section 10 on the tenant's right to buy, I would just be interested to hear your thoughts on the fact that the bill repeals Section 99 of the 2016 Act and instead gives Scottish ministers the power to make regulations modifying the requirement to register a tenant's interest in exercising their right to buy. Do you agree with this approach? Mr. Dunlop, perhaps you'd like to go first. I appreciate there's quite a substantial written submission that you've
made. Happy to do so, because before the 2016 Act, historically after the 2003 Act, a 1991 Act tenant had to register his or her right to buy, so they had to take action, so there was a register so you could see which tenants had registered their right to buy. The 2016 Act sought to remove the need to register, but as you'll be aware, that legislation has not made it to the statute book, it's not enacted, so we're now looking at changing that, and I support going back to what we had before, what we still have, which is that you have to register. And the reason for that is it removes any uncertainty as to where the boundaries of a tenancy lie. I've come across in practice a number of scenarios where there is a dispute whether the tenancy starts in that field or on that boundary. And I think in the world of land transparency, it makes perfect sense to have a register of the tenant's right to buy. I don't agree with some views that have been expressed that this is a cumbersome or onerous process. I've done it for clients. It's not difficult. You have to fill out a form and submit a map. There's sometimes a bit of coming and going with the landlord as to where the boundaries stop and start, but I really don't understand any objection to the tenant having to register their right to buy. I think it's a good thing.
Okay, and I presume that's also towards the completion of the land register, which is helpful.
Yeah, I mean, the tenant's right to buy wouldn't appear on the land register, but it all ties in with transparency and visibility.
Having a full account on the land register.
Apologies. And I think this is quite an easy one to sort out. There's other parts in the bill that deserve your time more than this.
Gil, I saw you expressing some thoughts on that. I wonder if you want to verbalise them.
No, completely agree with Grierson. You know, it's very welcome that Section 99 of the 2016 Act has been repealed for the reasons of clarity, if nothing else. We think that, you know, anything that is going to be proposed going forward, robust stakeholder engagement is going to be required, but we are 100% supportive of the Register of Community Interest in Land. Again, the increased clarity and certainty that gives to all parties concerned.
Can I just add one further point? I appreciate it's not a question, but forgive me. One of the problems we've had in the last 20 years following the right to buy coming in is the trigger point at which a right to buy is triggered, and we have no clarity in that really through legislation or case law, and it may be beyond the remit of this bill, but it would be really helpful for all of us in practice and all of our clients, tenants and landlords alike to have some clarity from Holyrood as to when the right to buy is triggered. And what I mean by that is if a tenant registers his or her right to buy, is that triggered when the landlord has an informal chat with a house builder, or is it triggered when a formal legal contract is signed? And we don't know, and we've been debating this for 20 years.
So you'd see this bill as an opportunity, if it's within scope, to clarify that matter.
That can be taken away by the committee. You would make a lot of lawyers smile.
Okay.
you don't have to say, Ben, whether that's an incentive or disincentive. But I also note that the bill team is sitting at the back, and they're probably noting that as well.
I'll add to that is, of course, we will seek the views of tenant farmers on these matters as well. And thank you for your feedback.
Thanks, Ben. Mark, I think you've got some questions now.
Yeah, I wanted to ask about your views on resumption. In other words, a landlord's ability to take back land under tenancy agreement before the lease is concluded. So I think, Ms Watt, Mr Dunlop, you both had some concerns about the provisions that are within the bill. So do you want to start?
The Society doesn't agree with the proposed changes to the resumption process. This is on the basis of the retrospective effect of this on existing commercial arrangements, and that's going to have wide-ranging practical and legal implications. Whatever changes are to be made in terms of lease going forward is a distinct issue from existing commercial arrangements, which may have been in place for decades and have been put in place after detailed commercial negotiations between the parties. And that could also involve a shorter resumption period.
Okay. Do you think that's fixable within the bill?
Possibly.
Okay.
I think the resumption provisions are problematic, and it's probably the part of the bill that jumps out most to practitioners like me. As Gail said, these tend to be contractually agreed clauses in a secure 1991 Act tenancy, which might not have been entered into but for the presence of a resumption clause. Typically, it's a two-month notice period given by the landlord to the tenant. If a resumption notice is required, I should say that typically land is often taken back by negotiation without the need for a resumption notice. There'll be a bilateral agreement and there'll be a compensation payment made to the tenant. So the statutory framework is not always invoked in certain circumstances in Ag Holdings, and this is an example where things tend to be agreed by negotiation. The problem with what's proposed is, there's a number of problems. Shifting it from a two-month to a one-year notice period is problematic. Involving the Tenant Farming Commissioner, I think, is an unnecessary step. I have had many dealings with the Tenant Farming Commissioner. I have found them productive. I don't know if it's necessary. I don't think it's necessary to invoke the TFC in this. There'll be resources questions as to whether the TFC and his or her office needs to get troubled with this. The compensation provisions have been cut and pasted from relinquishment and assignation, and I saw Bob McIntosh's evidence to you last week, and he made that point himself. I think that's problematic. I accept that tenants may feel that five times the rent is not a particularly generous compensation when a valid resumption is followed through. I think maybe there could be an increase in the multiplier if that would appease some of those concerns. Bringing in a capital value for the resumed land is controversial. Relinquishment and assignation is when a tenant gives up the whole holding, but here we could be talking about a very small area of ground, and therefore I don't think it's appropriate to carry over the same valuation provisions. Another concern is that the 2003 Act brought in what were to be the workhorses, the go-to leases of agricultural letting in Scotland, the SLDT and the then LDT that became an MLDT. That's not too many acronyms for you.
Could you just for the official
of course,
report,
forgive me.
If you could just expand.
Of course. So
that,
the 2003 Act brought in a short limited duration tenancy of up to 5 years, and originally a limited duration tenancy of 15 years and above. That then became 10 years and above. And as a quick aside, can I just say that in Scotland, two consenting adults cannot enter into a farm lease of between 5 and 10 years. And I don't understand why, if the Bill Committee or the Bill team could take that away and see if we could deal with that lacuna in the legislation, that would be terrific as well. Because if a client asks me, I want to do a lease for 7 years, I have to say we can't. So back to the 2003 tenancies. I'm on a bit of a rant here, forgive me. The 2003 Act brought in a statutory power of resumption under Section 17, and this bill proposes to tinker with that. And as soon as you start tinkering with the 2003 fixed-term duration tenancies, you're going to diminish the already faltering faith in landlords in letting land in Scotland. So I think this part of the bill needs to be looked at very carefully at this stage and at subsequent stages.
Okay, thanks for that. And I think you've already mentioned the Scottish Land Commission's evidence last week, where they were concerned about that imbalance between compensations available on resumption and those that are being offered an incontestable notice to quit. Ms. Watt, do you want to comment on that as well? Or?
We have no substantive comments in respect of compensation.
Yeah. Mr. Donald, have you got any more reflections on that imbalance?
But, Bob McIntosh, he raised that as almost a postscript to his evidence last week, and I can understand the concern on tenants' part that if they are served with an incontestable notice to quit, which would remove the entire tenancy from that tenant, that is not covered by the bill. And there's maybe a slight irony that there is valuation provision coming in for a 5-acre field, but not for the whole holding, if that makes sense. So I understand why Bob McIntosh raised that point. And it was under discussion previously, but it's not in the bill just now.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Colquhoun, have you anything to add?
The determination of compensation and the appropriate levels of compensation aren't really something that we even get involved with, let alone have a view on. We did notice one potential sort of quite important but very niche point that the committee might want to consider, which is the assessment of land value, assuming that the basis of the new compensation valuation is going to be the value of the land. There is a question in our own mind about whether or not that valuation would take into account development uplift. The default position is that it would be. We understand that resumption would take place quite frequently. For example, if you for a house site, for example, and there is a considerable difference in value between the bare agricultural value of half an acre and that same piece of land with planning permission for a house. And if you're going to use the land value as the basis of your compensation for to the tenant, it should be very clear on the bill whether you are intending bare agricultural value to be used or the value with the development uplift. And looking at paragraph 4 of the proposed new Schedule 2A to the 91 Act, we were concerned that that wasn't clear.
Okay.
I think that's a very important point for clients. If you own the land and you're looking to resume a five-acre plot, your expectation would be you'd be paying out on agric value. On the basis that it is a lease of a farm, it's an agricultural lease, it's not a lease of a non-agricultural use. And clarity in that would be very helpful, because that's one of the questions we've been asked by a lot of stakeholders since the bill was published. So I agree.
Does that reflect, you know, patterns in changing land use diversification we might see? I mean, another example comes to mind in my head about a solar farm, for example, where you've still got an element of agricultural, you know, operation, but it may be quite different, and then you've got, you know, the lease for the generation as well.
Yeah, there's a lot of these on the go just now, solar projects, battery storage, and a lot of those do involve resuming land. But I think the starting point, logically, for me, would be to resume the land for agricultural value on the basis that if the tenant were then had to go and find some other land, they'd be going to find agricultural land, not non-agricultural development land. So I'm not sure that quite answers your question. But
yeah, okay. Thanks.
Kristen, just before we leave that, so I understand it, the 91 Act, if there's no right of resumption in the Act, there's no right to resume. So you can't force the tenant to give up land. So
that's correct. Unless it's in the lease for a 91 Act tenancy, there's no right to resume. So it would become a bilateral negotiation between landlord and tenant. And obviously in those cases, it's no secret the tenant has a far stronger hand.
But from your experience, when it comes to resumption, is a hard nose, you're only entitled to 5 times the rent, or is there some sort of give and take on both sides so that there may be ways to make it more palatable to the tenant to allow the landlord? I just wonder if it's just matter-of-factly dealt with.
I would say it's a negotiation, and I would say in my experience the 5 times the rent is not something that a tenant would typically settle for. Obviously it depends on the tenant and the advice the tenant's receiving, but typically there's a more creative negotiation that takes place between the parties. The end point, hopefully, is the tenant gives up the land without feeling too sore about it, and the landlord gets the land back without feeling too sore about it as well.
So if the tenant's being creative, does the landlord have to be creative as well?
Absolutely. With all of this legislation, so much of it only comes into play when the landlord and tenant cannot agree. And in the majority of cases, I'm pleased to report the landlord and tenant do come up with a bilateral settlement which doesn't involve the legislation.
Okay. Gail, you're nodding. Are you agreeing, or was I not supposed to see that nod?
No. I'm agreeing with Grierson.
Okay. Thank you. The next questions then come from Jackie, who's been very quiet for the meeting so far. Jackie.
Thank you, Convener. Just 2 very quick questions, because I notice that the time's getting past us. And it's in regards to compensation payments when improvements are made, when the tenancy is ended, I mean. Can I ask your views on the provisions on compensation for improvements? Do you think that they are clear enough? And if not, how can they be improved? And I'll just open it up.
I can answer that very quickly. We don't have a view or a position on that.
Okay.
I'm happy to offer a view. The improvements, the list of improvements in terms of the classes, there's three at the moment. They're looking to introduce a fourth one, which I don't think is necessary. I think it's looking to complicate what's already complicated, and there's a bit of a theme developing in the evidence I'm giving here. I think we could deal with this in a simpler way to give clarity for all parties. They're looking to deal with principles and not a closed list of improvements. My personal preference is that we do have a closed list of improvements, so we don't have to trot off to the Land Court in years to come to work out whether or not that particular improvement qualifies or not. So I agree with the principle of updating it, but I think updating and simplification would be a better route here.
Okay. And if before the tenancy ends, if the tenant farmers making improvements to the land, do you think that should be considered when the rent comes across?
Yeah, well, we may come on to rent review, but typically a qualifying improvement, the tenant would not be charged rent on that because it's there because of the tenant.
Yeah, you don't think it's fair that would happen?
No, I think if the tenant builds a shed, then the landlord shouldn't be paid for the presence of that shed because it's only there because of the tenant, and that's an accepted principle.
Yeah, okay, thank you. Fergus?
No view.
Okay. And if my second question is about diversification, again, interested to hear what your views are on the operation of the proposals, and again, are they sufficiently clear? Mr Dunlop, I think it's you.
To hog the mic, but I think it does make sense in principle to give tenants a chance to diversify into environmental projects and the like. I think I do have a slight concern that the 2003 provisions about the landlord's right to objective diversification, they are fettered and slightly chopped off by the bill. The landlord can object to a diversification proposal by a tenant where, for certain reasons, such it would affect the amenity of the holding, or it would reduce the agricultural element of the holding, or if there was hardship. And what this bill appears to seek to do is to limit the landlord's right to object to that if the diversification has an environmental purpose. So I think a bit of clarity would be helpful there as just to how that would actually work in practice. So, because a landlord wouldn't want to be given a notice for a significant diversification project which would completely change the nature of the holding. So I think they're, in principle, yes, but I'm slightly concerned about the wording on the landlord's, the limits on the landlord's right to object.
So you'd have, I'm sorry, I don't mean to put words in your mouth and you'll correct me. So small diversifications, you don't see there being an issue in principle, depending
absolutely
on what they are,
no
but
need,
big ones
indeed
you would
yeah,
have.
I'm fine with that. Again, it's the age-old question, when do you get to the threshold that stops it being small is
okay
obviously the question.
So were you wanting to add anything?
Yeah, our main point on this was, as Grierson said, the need for clarity, especially in relevant definitions and how these are going to interact with the existing definitions used routinely through the agricultural holdings legislation. I am starting to sound like a broken record, and I do apologise for it, but our view across all of this is consistency is key. We cannot have two systems running concurrently that are at odds or just slightly different to one another. And one of the points that one of our members raised was that it's unclear from the bill as it stands whether the proposals for the part use of the land for non-agricultural purposes would mean it would fall out with the agricultural holdings legislation. And, you know,
I think there's always a potential tension, sorry to jump in, yeah, about environmental elements coming into an agricultural lease and whether there was a neater solution would be to extract that environmental use land from the agricultural tenancy, but there would obviously be a concern on the part of the tenant there that they may be giving up security of tenure for that section of the lease. It's just the slight tension as to how you mould or crowbar in non-traditional farming enterprises with the traditional use of a agricultural holding.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Jackie. Mark, I think, did you indicate you might want a supplementary here on this one?
Actually, possibly, and I'll move on to the next question, because just on your last point, Mr Dunlop, does that then not make the case, though, for a model environmental lease? You're saying it's very difficult to crowbar in
farm improvements into standard agricultural leases.
I think
I'm just wondering how that...
So if you were to extract land from an agricultural holding that was going to be used for environmental purposes, you would just enter into a regular commercial lease.
Right, okay.
I see. And if the government are intent on producing a model lease, we won't ignore it or poo-poo it, but just I don't think it's necessary. But in those circumstances, I agree, if you extracted 100 acres from I don't know how many football pitches that is, but 100 acres from a tenancy, you could just move that onto a different type of lease. But there may be concerns on the duration of that lease and the tenure, the security of tenure which the tenant might enjoy there.
So. Okay. I think I understand your point better now. And I've written down consistency is key as well, so don't worry about that. Okay, can I just then turn briefly to the process that happens at the end of a tenancy, the WAGO process? So, should that kind of standard claims procedure, should that apply to, sort of all types and sizes? And is there enough, flexibility within that procedure to take account of unforeseen circumstances?
I'll let you jump in there. In my almost 25 years, I haven't actually had to deal with many statutory claim procedures because many of them, in fact, most of them are done by negotiation. So the landlord and tenant, in whatever circumstances the tenancy is coming to an end, they will, with their respective advisers, negotiate the financial settlement in relation to that termination. I personally have not come across significant delays in tenants being paid out of their due entitlement, but I'm perfectly happy with the proposal that we do try and simplify and foreshorten that period, because much of the discussion over the years has been to allow tenants to retire with dignity, and part of that should be being paid out swiftly. And therefore, the principle behind it is fine. We need to work on the timescales to make sure that they're realistic in terms of a valuer being appointed quite a bit in advance of the actual termination date, because things can change in a short period. But I entirely support the idea that there should be no delays. And if there's interest to be charged, yes, but only when the delay is due to the acts or omissions of the person that's due to pay the money.
Right. So it's more a case of codifying good practice that's already in existence.
I noticed that the Valuers Association suggested an alternative was to get the Tenant Farming Commissioner to appoint a valuer, and I'm not against that idea.
Okay.
But I think it's only fair that these processes should be simplified and made quicker.
Okay. Ms. Watts?
Not much to add on the back of that, other than clear timescales help encourage cooperation, and that's all anybody wants at that point.
Yeah.
I don't think I really have anything to add.
Okay, that's fine.
Sir Mestman.
Thank you.
I'm going to go backwards, if I may, just on diversification, just very briefly. Could you give me an example of what you think the diversification could be that could significantly change an agricultural holding? I mean, are you talking about caravan parks? Are you talking about, what are you talking about?
Well, historically, there's been examples such as a farm shop, which has been carried out as a diversification, or a farm park or some sort of tourist attraction. That is the example we've seen in the past, convener. Going forward, I presume that the idea here would be maybe for more environmental projects, which is, I think, what the bill has in mind. And I'm talking about a larger scale. It would take up more acreage than a farm shop or a smaller scale project.
So, but if you diversified a proportion of the holding, which meant farming the remainder of the holding became impossible, is that allowed? Is that some concern on that?
There is a concern. I mentioned that, or tried to mention it previously, in terms of the 2003 grounds for objection are where there would be hardship to the landlord, or it would reduce the agricultural element, or it would affect the amenity. And my concern about the bill is those rights of objection are restricted if the diversification is ticking all the boxes on the environmental front. As important as that is, it's the tricky balance between allowing the landlord to retain his or her land in its form against the environmental needs of and what's proposed by the diversification.
So just before I bring Jackie in, just so I understand that, just say you had a a 600 hectare farm, of which 300 hectares were put into Christmas trees, for example, and that's because the existing farmer only wanted to run a smaller number of sheep and cattle. But subsequently, it would be impossible to farm a greater number of sheep and cattle because it was in Christmas trees. But does that does the landlord have a what rights does the landlord have there, or does he not have any?
I think in those circumstances, the landlord would have a strong case for objecting to the diversification if they're going to turn half the farm into a Christmas tree farm, I think, in those circumstances.
Okay. Jackie, you wanted to come in?
Yes, it was. I mean, what's being discussed is diversification for environmental reasons, but I'd be keen to hear what your views are on if a part of the land, and I don't even mean a big part, was the tenant was trying to just to try and subsidise his earnings, so to actually keep the agricultural part of the land going. What would your views? I'm thinking a scrambling park in one of the parks, for instance, that wouldn't be in his lease, but it might actually help the income coming in might actually help him keep going, or her.
Again, I'm in principle fine with that, and some of the evidence from the Scottish Tenant Farmers Association has talked about the need to diversify to augment incomes in a challenging environment for Scotland's farmers. So, and that's probably the genesis of diversification way back in the previous legislation, in terms of allowing tenant farmers to go out with the regular sphere of agriculture to source other income. So I'm okay with that.
As long as it doesn't harm the land at the end of the day, of course.
You don't want to jigger the whole farm.
I'm going to go on briefly on to game damage. I raised a question, I think, last week about deer. And what we were told was deer could be controlled by the tenant farmer if they were damaging them with an enclosed field. But the legislation allows the tenant to claim against the landlord, which for deer which may be coming from the next-door neighbour, which the landlord has no control over, and the deer could control themselves. I'm confused who's responsible for what. Maybe Grierson, you can help me, or Fergus.
I'll jump in quickly. I share that confusion and concern that I think the particular section of the bill needs a bit of work to try and avoid the landlord being on the hook for something over which the landlord has no control. I don't do a lot of work in the north of the country. I don't have a lot of experience of game damage or damage by deer, but I am concerned that the wording of this section does not quite cater for the scenario that you mentioned, Convener. So I think a little bit of work is required here.
Fergus, do you want to add anything to that?
It's worth noting that the proposed modified version of Section 52 of the 91 Act only applies where the tenant doesn't have the right to kill or take game. So that aspect of it is perhaps not so significant. I can quite see the difficulty that might be caused if the deer are coming from somewhere that the landlord has no control over, but the faculty doesn't take a view generally on this part of the bill.
Okay, and I think my other concern was that it talks about fixed equipment, which I'm assuming is not the buildings, it's the fences. So convention is that liability falls 50% either way, as far as the damage is concerned, and if they're coming from somebody else's ground, it all then falls to the landowner under this legislation. I'm not sure I follow that.
I think typically fixed equipment in these circumstances would be fencing. And I think if there's a march fence and it's normally 50-50, if somebody else has caused the issue, there would be a common law right of redress against the person that caused the damage, so you wouldn't be left paying for that. But as I say, all of this could be improved in the section of the bill.
Okay, and then I'm going to ask a question on rent reviews and the legislation here. I mean,
I've done a few rent reviews in my time, and it sort of indicates in the bill that I stuck my finger in my mouth to check which way the wind was blowing, and that's the way I sorted out the rent. It's slightly more technical than that. Do you think the bill makes light of it, or do you think it creates complexities in that? Who'd like to go on that? Gail?
We don't have substantive comments on this. However, we are seeking clarity, again, on the defined terms which are being used here, highlighted one being productive capacity.
Yeah, I agree with your comments. Typically, when landlords and tenants meet, a rent is more often than not agreed by negotiation over a cup of tea or a glass of whisky around the kitchen table, and that is often what happens. But there are exceptions to that, and there have been two or three very expensive and drawn-out rent review cases that have gone through the Scottish Land Court, which are the only ones that have really gone the full way. The 2016 Act focused on productive capacity. I think the Scottish Government commissioned a firm of land agents to do an expensive study into what productive capacity meant, and for a variety of reasons that legislation has never made it into practice. I'm okay with the proposals in principle. There's a little bit of work required just to make sure some of the benefits of what we call the old Section 13 and the case law emanating from that is not thrown out. We're looking at a hybrid between market rents and comparable evidence based on other farms. Productive capacity is going to be in there in the mix, and also the economic circumstances. And I would urge the committee, I presume you are going to be taking evidence from suitably qualified or experienced land agents who are at the coalface of these discussions, because they'll be able to provide evidence beyond what I can. But I think what's proposed is subject to a bit of tinkering, better than other parts of the bill.
The other question I had is diversification being encouraged. A lot of farms have more than one house, but the farm may only produce enough work for one family. So sometimes they are used as holiday lettings or indeed places for retired members or younger members of the family to live. That's not in the rent review and they're excluded. Is that right?
I think housing generally needs to be brought into the, or at least be more interaction between the housing bill and this bill. And that's one of the examples where I think there needs to be more interaction. A plea to everybody here at Holyrood would be to try and allow that the housing within agricultural tenancies to be catered for within the housing bill. I appreciate it's a small number compared to the millions of houses elsewhere, but it is a bit of a headache in terms of not only rent reviews, but where does liability start if you have a landlord, a farm tenant, and an employee or a subtenant, a lawful subtenant. Who's on the hook for putting in smoke detectors? Who's on the hook for water testing? And I know this is maybe quite a niche concern, but it is something that I come across in practice. And if we could have clarity, you know, the quality of Scotland's housing stock and the availability of Scotland's housing stock is important, but there is a lack of talking to from one bit of legislation to the other.
So if the deemed landlord was the land owner and they had to do all that work, would it not be reasonable for them to expect some return for that work in the rent? Or if the deemed landowner, the landlord was the tenant, obviously they need to offset some of their costs for all that work as well.
Yes, it would only be reasonable that who's benefiting from that particular house or property, it should be reflected in the rent.
It does seem somewhat confusing. Fergus or Gail, do you want to add to that?
Houses on agricultural tenancies are excluded from an awful lot of legislation which otherwise affects housing in Scotland. Not all of it, which can catch people out. There is quite a lot of complexity around how that legislation works, and it certainly would be sensible to keep it in consideration.
OK, I'm looking around to see if any other committee members want to ask any further questions. Without opening this up to a long diatribe of everything we've missed, is there anything that you particularly think we've missed that we ought to be thinking about in future sessions? And I would ask you to limit that, but if there is something that you think we need to concentrate on.
I'll just quickly say I think it would be helpful to have a clear definition of sustainable and regenerative agriculture. I know that's made on an easy task. And a wider comment, it ties a bit with what Mr McLeod and Dr Robbie said about the legislation in the context of Part 1. Lord Gill, who is the godfather of agricultural holdings legislation, former Lord President, who may be known to some of you, he made an excellent speech at the Agricultural Law Association conference in 2016 when he pleaded for simplicity and consolidation of the legislation. When he started in the 1960s, there was one act with eight schedules. We now have more acts than I can care to count, with lots of schedules, lots of intermingling with land reform legislation. It's complicated for people like me, who are supposed to know what they're doing, let alone people who don't know what they're doing. And the consolidation of the legislation is not an easy task, but if we could get to that point, it would be wonderful.
Yeah.
Just on that, you'll be aware that Parliament will pass another bill today in all likelihood in that space. I mean, are you arguing that the land reform bill process ahead of us, obviously we're partaking in stage one today, is an opportunity for that consolidation, or are you proposing perhaps more practically that in the next parliamentary term a consolidation act might be a good option to consider?
The second of those. I've maybe gone slightly off piece with my plea for a consolidation of ag holdings legislation, but and we haven't touched on the Agriculture and Communities Bill, which is important to the future of agriculture, and that does tie in with the rent review discussions and the future of the tenanted and the owner-occupying sector. So it's all the hope that all of this legislation can, where possible, talk to each other.
Thank you.
Fergus or Gail, do you want to add anything?
On you go.
No, I think I've said all that I can say. I suppose it would be perfectly reasonable for me to echo what Grayson has said about simplicity in the legislation. That is important for the very obvious reason that people who are not lawyers need to be able to read this and understand this. And I speaking personally, as a general rule of thumb, think that if you're putting new sections in a bill that have more than one letter after them, as for example section 32ZB, then it might be time to consider consolidating legislation at some point.
And can I just finish by saying the reason I think the law needs to be simplified is that we have a problem with rented farmland in Scotland. We have lots of willing tenants who are not able to rent farms because the legislation discourages landlords from renting land, and the very aims of the legislation that have come out of this place have had the opposite effect in terms of people are scared to let land because of further legislation that will further restrict their rights as landlords. The right people are not farming lots of Scotland's land because the legislation is stopping that happening, and the legislation should be making that happen.
So I've got to ask a question on the back of that. Is this going to make more tenanted farms or less?
Fewer, I think.
Fewer. Okay. If there's nothing else, thank you very much. It's been a long session, and I'm sorry that we've slightly taken your time for longer than we anticipated, but it is a complex bill, and we will struggle to come to terms with it over the autumn as well, I think, as we get to complete it. So thank you very much for your time and sharing your views so freely. We are now going to move into private session. Thank you very much.